firstly, welcome and afternoon, everyone. I'm here to introduce the main act, which is Matthew and Ella Mills, the founders and co-CEOs of Deliciously Ella. Brief intro, many of you know this, but just to remind you, originally launched as a blog back in 2012, following Ella's journey to cure ill health through a natural and plant-based diet. Deliciously Ella is now one of the leading international food and lifestyle brands, and it's been a phenomenal success in a very, very short period of time. And Ella, I'll start with you. Can you just tell us a bit about where it all came from and the background behind it and the sort of genesis of the whole story?
I started Deliciously Ella as a really personal project. Back in 2011, I was studying at St. Andrews and I got really unwell. I spent about 4 or 5 months in and out of different hospitals and was diagnosed with a condition that affected the functioning of my autonomic nervous system. And I was put on all kinds of medication and steroids, started taking them all across that year. They didn't do a huge amount for me, and I really, really struggled with that physically, in not really being able to do anything. And so I decided I would deal with those issues and the issue of kind of really struggling with what to do with my time. And I would start writing a blog, which would give me a hobby, and I would learn food photography, and I would talk to strangers online about healthy food, and I would teach myself to cook, and that's where Deliciously Ella came from. And I started writing it, and my mom was definitely the only reader for the first few months. She was very loyal, but she started sharing it with friends. Friends started sharing it with friends, and over the first year, it had a million hits, and people started emailing in, and they were cooking the recipes in Australia and the Philippines and all around the world, and people started really connecting to it. And at the same time, it was starting to really help me physically as well. And so I started thinking about how I take it to the next level, and a friend said, oh, what about Instagram? Have you ever heard of that? And I hadn't at that point. This is now 2013. And anyways, I discovered it. I thought it would be a good tool for inspiring me to keep sharing what I was doing. And so I started an account on there, and that really started to push the blog, and people there started asking for cooking classes and workshops and supper clubs. So I responded to that, and that was the kind of first commercial venture of Deliciously Ella. And then the next thing people wanted was an app, because blogs are slightly irritating to have to go through pages and pages and pages to find a recipe. So I released an app, and that was kind of the first way of testing the waters of whether or not it was something that people would actually connect to, they'd be willing to part with $3.99 for. And it went to number one on iTunes Store overnight in the UK and the US, and that was just on the back of our social media. So that was quite surprising and astonishing. And on the back of that, I was approached to write a book, and I thought it seemed quite ironic because I didn't really feel like I knew what I was doing at this point.
Do you now feel like you know what you're doing?
Not really. Not really, no. But a little bit more than I did then. So I wrote that, and that came out, and that was kind of an amazing insight into this new tool of digital media and the power of community that you can create through it, because I didn't have 1.1 million followers then. I had about 150,000, but it was such a strong community that we sold out of books before the book was published, and that's not something that the publisher had ever come across before. And as a result, the media massively picked up on it. The whole thing kind of exploded, and it became the fastest selling debut cookbook ever in the UK. But I met Matt, no, I will stop talking in a second, just to give you the background, a couple of months after that. And I was really enjoying what I was doing. I was passionate about it. We had amassed this huge community at this point. People were so connected to it. And we had this amazing channel to talk to them, but I personally did not know how to take it to the next level on my own. I'd never had another job before. Matt started asking me initially things like a P&L, and I was like, what's that? And I was doing job interviews for people, having never had a job interview in my life, just saying, oh, you look nice, will you help me? And so I really needed help, and our parents actually introduced us and we started dating and working together, and that's really how we took it to the next phase.
So in our relationship, everything had gone incredibly quickly. So We moved in a week later, we got a dog after a month, and so we were kind of going at this light speed, and we started dating in March, about 2 months after Ella's first book came out, and we went for a walk in May, and we were walking through the park, and we were like, isn't it annoying that the restaurants I want to go to, you can only eat sides, and the restaurants you want to go to are kind of these weird hippie places. I was like, this is stupid. We should start a business together.
You're in the business together, you're in a relationship together, you're doing things that you're passionate about together. I mean, two questions really. Firstly, you know, how do you feel about it as a job versus a passion? And secondly, you know, everyone talks these days about eating healthy and eating clean, and you can become a bit cynical about it. I mean, what's the philosophy, at least that for you, that underlies what you're trying to do with the business?
So I think, I mean, I know I wake up and I'm hugely inspired by Ella and what she does and the way she's built this community of people. You know, our social media channels talk to 28 million people a month, and I think we wake up each day with a great sense of purpose. There's 27% of people in the UK get their five a day. We have a huge obesity problem, and this isn't about a weight loss program or showing abs. This is about just getting people to eat a bit better and providing the tools to do that.
Help us understand, I mean, how do you think about this? You've talked to us about how personal this journey was at the beginning, and you're unbelievably candid about it, which is hugely refreshing. But in the end, you know, you are now building a big business, but a business that is inextricably linked to you on a personal basis. Particularly given, you know, what's the name? I mean, how do you manage that balance?
It's a great question. It's something that we're very, very conscious of, and we all talk about a lot. It's interesting, at the moment, that personal edge has given us just this kind of unbelievable advantage. I mean, I think that we are still kind of continuously surprised every time by how much it's helped. I mean, as of now, we still don't have any marketing people in our team. That's probably a mistake. We actually are now looking to hire on that side. But we've got up until now to 5,500 stores with no marketing team, no internal creative team. We've had PR for like 4 months now.
No advertising.
And we're outselling our competitors in pretty much every single store that we sell in, and we're even creating incremental growth within the category, which is amazing. And that is all through the power of social media. I still spend probably about 4 hours a day replying to absolutely everything. And again, everybody more experienced, more professional, more senior than me that I have met has said, you are insane. That seems like a completely terrible use of your time. But it's created this one-on-one relationship with people that creates a feeling of trust and authenticity and credibility within what is such a confusing space within the supermarket. And that just has such an amazing value. But as you said, at the same time, if we're going to scale, it can't all be linked on that.
But it is. I mean, people are blown away when Ella tells people that she responds to every single Instagram comment herself. They just... people and Facebook and Twitter.
So one the audience
can test. Yeah, I mean, it's completely nuts. And so, but it means that our feedback loop is just so quick, and we're getting such incredible customer feedback from such an engaged audience all the time, that it's completely and utterly invaluable. I mean, I think companies.
Are you comfortable with that?
Yes, no. I think completely. It depends when you ask me, actually. I mean, I think to a certain extent, it's very weird to operate. I'm actually quite an introvert at heart. Never started this to be famous. And it's quite a strange thing in a way, kind of getting your head around the fact that you exist in a public space and that people will have inevitably opinions on you, and inevitably lots of those will be negative. Of course they will, and there's not much you can do about that, and it's quite strange that everyone kind of in a sense feels like they own a piece of you, and like if you don't reply, you suddenly get people kind of sending you angry face emojis, and you're like, I'm so sorry, like, you know, it's 9 o'clock on a Sunday night, like, give me a tiny bit of a break. But the thing is that we just have so much to be grateful for from it, because you look at people, yeah, who've been trading for years in this category, who have amazing businesses, and when you start overtaking them, when you've only been stocked in that retailer for 3 months, and it's because you replied to that, it's kind of incredible.
So what's the vision now? You know, I mean, you've, you're no longer a startup. I mean, you still have the culture of a startup, but you know, you've got this amazing product business and the delis and the books. I mean, where do you want to go, and you know, what's the strategy?
So, I mean, we openly say that we want to be the biggest health food business in the UK. And one of the beauties of Delicious Yella is that we can play across so many different product categories. So with a lot of products, they will launch a product and build a brand around that product, but they wouldn't be able to pivot. You know, if you're a naked snack bar, you couldn't then go pivot into pasta sauces or something else. Whereas...
Well, not without creating another brand.
Yeah, or creating another brand. Whereas the beauty of Delicious Yella, we think, is that we can play across this whole field. And Delicious Yella is known for anything from energy balls to granola to oat bars to pasta sauces to smoothies. And so we're really excited about, I mean, one of the first things we really found when we looked at the free-from space, which is typically where our products are stocked, is was just how fragmented it was and how small the brands were and how everything was just kind of brown or craft paper and there was nothing optimistic or exciting about it. And we really wanted to bring that sense of optimism and deliciousness to it and try and consolidate that space. And so we're definitely moving fast and we're being aggressive, but we want to play across a lot of fields.
I think on behalf of everyone here, you know, we applaud you for that. And you know, thank you hugely for taking the time. It's been brilliant to hear what you had to say.
Pleasure, thank you.